y'all don't mind, let's go back to a time when we really used to have church. We used to have a good time, praising the Lord, in spirit and in truth.
I love them old
church. That old brother, pick up that old hymn book and
singing,
you knew exactly what he was gonna say. Sisters got happy, folks start patting their feet, clapping their hands, and all of a sudden he break off in a song something like this.
So Matthew chapter 11, we're going to underscore that, and then Luke 14 verse 15 through 24, underscore that, because I want to show you something that's happening today in what we call religion in America. Many times when people preach Matthew chapter 11, verse number 28 through 30, they preach this text as some type of form animal project. They, in Matthew 28, 11, verse number 28, that's what I want, 28, I'll say that backwards, Matthew 28, verse number 11, I'm sorry, y'all should have said something, but that's a lot of scripture. You said it was toward the end. They immediately go to the yoke, and they go to the ox, and they talk about putting a line between the ox. And I heard all these sermons, and I was missing the teaching in Matthew 28, verse number 11. Read it with me, if you will, and let's gander over it just for a minute. I hope I'm in the right text. But I won't come under me, all you the heavy laden, the heavy burden, and I'll give you, I've never been in the right place.
That was 28, yeah, that was 11:28.
Yeah, I was in the right spot, okay, I fooled myself, okay. Matthew 11, 28, so I was accurate. But I wanna, yeah, 28 through 30. But I want you to read this with me, because I want you to see what was really happening in this text, because it's gonna bless your life. And see it happening to us today. And I will do it quickly. And then I want you to see yourself in the text. And I want you to ask yourself, can we be this person? And if the answer is no, then fine. But if the answer is yes, then I want you to say, can we be better? Can I be this group of people? Well, no, then good. If yes, can I do better? So, in Matthew chapter 11, verse number 28, the Bible says, come unto me, and I want you to underscore come, all ye that are heavy laden and burdened. And what else does it say?
I'll give you rest.
What else does it say?
Take my yoke.
So that make the point of the yoke, and what else?
Take my yoke upon you.
And learn of me, for I am what?
I am meek and lowly in heart,
and you shall find rest for your soul. Matthew chapter 11 is a conclusory text in which Jesus has finally come to a place that he realized, he's talking to people, that he cannot help. Let me say it again. Matthew chapter 11, verse 28 is a conclusory passage of scripture. It is different than a doxology. It's not a final offering. It is Jesus realizing that you can't save everybody. And so he gives an invitation to those in those days who can still be taught. In the text, in chapter 11, in the chapter 12, are people called scribes and Pharisees, Essenes, called the teachers of the law, lawyers, who are teaching that the Messiah will come, and are now teaching that the Messiah is not Christ. And in Matthew chapter 12, they even called Jesus a devil. Jesus responded to them and said, if I was a devil, why would I be doing the Lord's work? For every house that is divided against itself shall not be able to stand. These people were handling the word of God. They were looking at The old law, which they had added some 700 laws to them, and they were studying the prophets. They were reading about the writings of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob. They were reading about the Mosaic law, how that the God of heaven would bring forth a son, Isaiah chapter 9, and that he would bring forth a son made of a virgin. And that his name shall be Emmanuel, Counselor, Mighty God. They were reading that. They were standing in front of Jesus. And they were telling Jesus and asking Jesus biblical questions. But they were not questions to confirm he was the Son of God. But they were questions that would lead to his death. They were studying God's word not to save souls, but studying God's word to kill the Son of God. And so they asked him questions. This coin that you have. This coin that you have, do we pay tribute to Caesar or do we pay tribute to man? He said, give that to Caesar, which is Caesar. Had he answered the question wrong, it would have cost his life. In other words, ladies and gentlemen, just as those people in those days who argued about the temple, who argued about the coin, who argued about working on the Sabbath, who gave a religiosity appearance and talked about church and talked about the word of God, didn't know Jesus was standing right in front of them and refused to accept him as their Lord and Savior. Jesus' response to them sometimes would be, he would say to them in Matthew chapter 25, about verse number 15, he says, search the scriptures, for in them you think you have eternal life, but these scriptures ought to lead you to me. In other words, he is saying to them that if you were such a Christian, and if you knew the word of God like you said you did, when you studied, you would not find yourself trying to hurt somebody with my word, but when you studied my word, it would lead you to where I am, because my word is who I am. Yeah. John chapter 5, he said in Matthew chapter 5, he said, let me tell you something, you do err, not knowing what? The scriptures, nor the power of God. And my friend, there are many churches and many people who are walking around with the Bible in their hand that wouldn't know Jesus' church if it slapped them in the face. There are many people that are sitting in front of us right now who have been in the church year after year, have studied the prophets, who have studied God's word, who looked at God's word, but their behavior after studying God's word is to kill folk rather than to bring life. God's word should bring life to people. God's word, the Bible says in John chapter 6, is a quickening power. His word will make dead folk rise up from the grave. His word will make you shout sometimes when you don't want to say something. His word will make you smile on a cloudy day. His word will give you hope when you're hopeless. His word will give you help when you feel like you're helpless. His word brings life. It does not destroy. And so they're studying, he's listening, he's wondering to himself, look at these people, look at my people, look at these people. And you remember you said in Matthew chapter 23 and verse 37, he said, all the times I would have taken you under my wing, I would have put my arms around you, and I would have protected you, I would have helped you pass all these fake churches, pass animalism, pass imperialism, pass a Sabbath day, an Old Testament fundamental worship. I would have brought you past it, but you won't come to me. And why you won't come to me is because there's been a mishandling of God's word. Well, how do you know? Matthew chapter 23 and verse number 5, he said, warn to your scribes and Pharisees, for you bring heavy laden and heavy burdens to be laid upon men. And this is why I started off saying what I was saying. It has nothing to do with a stock or a yoke on somebody, but when false doctrine is taught, when scripture is not taught right, it puts a heavy burden on your neck. It puts a heavy, heavy pressure on you. When folk try to tell you who you are in Christ, when folk try to deny you as a child of God, when folk try to determine your worth in the church, when folk try to determine your worth as a person, it becomes heavy. It becomes burdensome. And you find yourself saying, I am a Christian. I am a preacher. I am a child of God. But I don't need you to confirm my Christianity. God already said who I am.
Amen.
God already owned me as him. Am I right about it? And so the burden that we put on people, in order for you to come to church, you need to stop this, you need to stop that. Listen to the text, if you will. Come unto me, all ye that are heavy laden. Come unto me. In other words, come unto me just like you are. See, the scribes and the Pharisees, before you could come to them, you had to have studied, you had to go through certain education processes, you got to be in a certain clique, you got to be in a certain group, and if you ain't in that group, then you're not ready yet, and they had to proselyte you. What do you mean proselyte? Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, for you compass the sea and the land, Matthew chapter 23, to make one proselyte, and after that one proselyte made, you make it twice as likely to go straight to hell. Why? Because they didn't learn Jesus, they learned religion. And a lot of people learn religion, folks start walking away from religion, because if they learn religion, they're going to have
If they learn religion, they're going to hate giving. If they learn religion, they're going to put work before church. If they learn religion, they're going to put their family before church, before the Lord. If they learn religion, they're never going to hear God's voice. If they learn religion, they're twice as likely to go to hell. But if they learn Christ, praise God Almighty. If they learn Christ, they're going to be all right. Y'all say amen. Because he is the way, the truth, and the life. Y'all say amen. So he said, I don't want you to come to them. But if anybody's listening right now, come unto me, all you that are listening to me. I'm the Son of God. Come unto me, all you that are heavy laden and heavy burdened. If you got some hell going on in your life right now, if you're sick and tired of being sick and tired, you need to stop listening to religion, stop listening to other folk running their mouth, and start seeking what Jesus has to say. Yeah. Because God can speak a blessing in your life. Yeah. God can speak rest to your weary soul. Yeah. God can give you peace in the middle of the night. God can help you look at what the enemy is doing and laugh at the enemy in his face. Have you ever got a bill in the mail and bust out laughing? Folks, there's something wrong with you. They send a $500 life bill, you just start smiling. That's all right. That's right. Y'all must need the money. Amen. That's because you know you got a God that can do what? Y'all know what I'm saying? You got a God that can do what? He is the life. He can fix anything. Am I right about it? When you learn God and not religion, see, that's what's wrong with America right now. There is a battle and a hatred toward religion. And because folk are mad at religion, they are refusing to hear about Christ. Goodness. Why was that time, preachers? When you look at Luke chapter 14, Jesus fixed a great meal. And he says, bid all of them to come into my house and receive this good meal. And they all begin to make excuses, one at a time. Because religiously, he was not popular enough to go visit. Religiously, he was known as a religious fanatic. Religiously, they had identified him as an enemy of the state. Religiously, he was a poor carpenter. Religiously, he wasn't about nothing. He wasn't with the sect. He wasn't a Pharisee. He wasn't a scribe. He wasn't as cool as the rest of us. So when he says, come to me. I'm going to fix some food for you. They began to make excuses one by one. And Jesus said, let me tell you something. Go out to the highways and the byways because these church folk don't want what I got. Go out to the highway and get some folk who are showing up hungry and tell them I got some free food for them and watch my house be filled. Amen. But preach, what they got doing to me right now? What they got doing right now? The reason for go to church nowadays or for religious reasons. If they don't like the preacher, they ain't coming for the food. Y'all not say amen. Yeah. If they don't like the song service, they may or may not get up and come to service. If they don't like the location, they may not make it. Yeah. But if they were coming because Jesus is serving up some food up in here, y'all not say amen. Yeah, it's the difference in going to church and coming to Christ. Are y'all with me? I'm trying to. And the problem that we have seen, the problem with heaven, even up to our church of Christ, is that I gotta teach you, don't come to church. Because if you come to church, it's gonna be predicated on who's at church. But if you come to Christ, anywhere Christ is, you're gonna make sure that you're at that place. Y'all say amen. Yeah. When you invite folk to church, you're inviting them to your ideology about what church is. But when you invite people to an experience with Christ, you cause impact in their life. When you understand that when you get up and when you're not going to church, you're coming to Christ. And when Christ says, come unto me, all you that have been laden and burdened, he says, I want you to come just like you are. You ain't got to quit this. You ain't got to stop that. You ain't got to do this and jump and do three Hail Marys and two thank you Jesus and five Virgin Marys and two crisscross Chris. Well, you ain't got to do none of that. You just come up. But I'm a gambler. You and your lottery tickets report to the house of God promptly and tell God, I say amen. Come just like you are. Why? Because God's going to do the changing and the fixing in your life. And you not until you look to Jesus for your health and strength, you will always be going to church. Lord have mercy. Y'all alright, but y'all think I'm gonna save for this next week? I'm gonna save for this next week. Because this isn't good stuff. See, I didn't ask some stuff here. I'm gonna make this one point, I'm gonna sit myself down. Because here's the deal. See, for a long time, and I think this is what's been happening, because I talked to Brother Al. Brother Al, what's wrong, man? You can't be a preacher and not able to bring folk to church. What's wrong? I don't know. I said, you in the tradition. If you stop inviting people to church, and invite them to Christ, guess what's going to happen? How many of y'all feel like y'all going to invite people to Christ? How many of you been inviting people to church? Raise your hand. Yeah, that's what we do. We invite people to church. Yeah, we invite people to church. Folk mad at church. Do you know the average person feel like the church is a bunch of crooks and hypocrites? Do you like that? The head people talk to, when you say church, they're crooks and hypocrites. But invite them to Christ. The invitation is come unto me. All you come unto me. Those that are in this text and you're listening and you're not given to religion, if you're given to a church, you're not given to the Pharisees, to the scribes, to the Sadducees, if you're not listening to them, those that are listening, come unto me if you're heavy laden and burdened by this false teaching, and I'll give you rest. And I don't know about you, but I need some rest. I need some rest. And the Greek word, the word you use for rest is not the same as rest in sleep. It means that you have the propensity and the ability to find comfort and solace in no matter what state or condition you're in. Y'all, I say amen. Because there's some stuff you can get into that won't let you sleep at night. There's some stuff. Did you not know in a psychological study that every one of you have been lying for years because you said, I cannot multitask. If I said I need you to do 5, you say, one thing at a time. That's a lie. The average human being has 55,000 thoughts go through his head or her head in one day. That means in one day, whether you know it or not, you made 55,000 decisions by the time you went to bed. Mile on three, I'm asking you. If you can handle 55,000, you can show him the three that appreciate it. Y'all look, Google it, somebody Google it. How many thoughts does a person have in their head? And when they Google it, I love the Bible, they can Google and see if you lie. You can Google 55,000. You have been designed by God to multitask. You can multitask. And so yes, we can do it. Yes, we can be a powerful church, but we gotta stop inviting people to church. And so inviting people where? To Christ. We gotta stop trying to tell people what they're doing wrong. And let God handle how to write. Y'all are saying amen. Yeah. See, you sitting around saying like that, my brother, you won't go to church. You got to stop it. That ain't none of your business. That's God's business. God said, tell him to come. Just as he is. Take my yoke. Take me. Take me on. Learn how gracious I am. Y'all are saying amen. Yes. Learn how wonderful I am. Learn how powerful. Learn how loving I am. And in the midst of your stuff, you'll find rest for your soul. Man. I'm gonna say this for next week. God bless you. God keep you here today, and you've been religious, but you haven't been Christ. You gotta stand up and say, Lord, we go to this new place. Help me to be Christ. Help me to be Christ. Lord, unteach all that prescribes and pharisaic stuff. And all those ways that's going to help me lose my soul. Because they were studying God's word and sending folk to hell. Because they stopped teaching about Christ and started teaching about rules and laws and standards that they had set that God had not set. Yeah. I'm begging you that we can start over anyway. Let's start out being Christ's church and see what Christ do with the people that we bring in. And watch God change those people and work those people and move those people and take them to a higher level. And if God can accept them just like they are, you ought to show them hush your mouth. You ought to show, you show him how to say. If God can bless them just like they are, you ought to be quiet and look for your blessing. I don't know about you, but if God blessing you, I'm the when are you gonna bless me? Y'all stop. Bless it, hey. What do you bless her for? What do you bless her for? She do this. I'm not worried about that. Where is my blessing? You said, come all ye. I came too. Y'all about to say that. I came too. If John got his, where is mine? Amen. Y'all worried about the wrong thing that right there, man. If devil got his, where my blessing is? I ain't worried about why he blessing mine. If bad is mine, I live with it. If he blessing mine, bad as she is, then y'all to bless me. If I'm better than mine, where my blessing is? And Maya, don't you worry about folks messing with you. You, as long as you get your blessing, you shout amen. Can you say amen, Maya? Yeah. Say it like you mean. Say it like you preach a dog. Amen. You hear today, you heard the word, believe it, you heard, repent of sin, confess the sweetest son of mortal tongue, put him on in baptism. This race is between you and God. The invitation is inclusive. It's for everybody. The invitation is for everybody, just like you are, as we together stand and say the son of invitation.